As you mentioned, I mean, I've been looking into this whole field of research and scholarship, looking at the relationship between the brain and our religious and spiritual selves for about 30 years. I first connected with two mentors back in the early 1990s, one who was a in the field of nuclear medicine that got me very involved in doing brain imaging and studying all the things that you mentioned in the introduction, different disease states and so forth. And then I also had the good fortune to connect with a researcher who was a psychiatrist by training and also had a PhD in anthropology. And he had been looking at the relationship between the brain and religion, even further back, going into the 1970s. His name was Dr. Eugene DeQuilly, and but he had an interesting take on it. As an anthropologist, he was looking at kind of the where is the evolutionary piece to all of this. And so when I first met him, he was heavily involved in trying to explore that piece of this connection. And but we also realized that part of what we needed to do was to develop these neuroscientific tools to be able to study various types of rituals and practices like meditation and prayer and so forth. And so eventually, as I like to say, the proverbial light bulb went off, and I said, oh, gee, if we're doing all these brain scans of people who have Alzheimer's disease or depression or whatever, we're looking at these different mental states. Why can't we study the mental states associated with prayer and meditation and other types of spiritual practices? So that was really what kind of, started off in many ways, bringing neurotheology as a concept to reality. I mean, we'd always been talking about this relationship, but we never really had the brain scans, the science behind it, to help to put that whole connection together. But at the same time, I always kind of hearkened back to, and unfortunately, Gene DeQuilly left this earth a little too soon. I had been working with him for about 6 or 7 years when he died very suddenly of a very large heart attack. It was very, very upsetting and traumatic time for all of us who knew him well. But and so I kind of continued into the neuroscience world, which was certainly my world. But I had always had this longing to kind of reconnect with this discussion about the evolution of the brain and the evolution of different aspects of spirituality in the context of the brain. And part of that whole connection had to do with rituals. He loved rituals. He was always he would, we would go to these dinner parties that were loaded with rituals about what who was going to say certain things when and what drinks you would have and what songs you would sing and all kinds of crazy stuff. Meanwhile, around the table are like Nobel Prize winners, literally Nobel Prize winners and people who had revolutionized psychology and medicine and all this. But they're all doing these kind of fun and crazy rituals. And the reason that rituals were so important to him was that they are a fundamental part of religion. And in fact, they're a fundamental part of virtually every aspect of human life, but specifically religious and spiritual traditions. And so, all of us who have grown up or known anything about a given tradition know that there are ceremonies, there are holidays, there are practices, there are things that you do over and over again. There's a rhythmic element to them, both in terms of what you're doing in the moment, but also a kind of rhythmic element to them in terms of doing them every year at the same time, doing, passing them on from generation to generation. The rhythms kind of, build on top of each other. But where do all these kind of rituals and rhythms come from? Well, if you're an anthropologist, the answer is that, well, they had to evolve in the brain. And if rituals found their way into the human brain, they most likely got there through rituals in other brains, in other animals' brains. And this is where we start to head in this direction, to your question, which is that if we look at animal rituals, and the animal world is loaded with rituals, there's all kinds of rituals and very complex and dancing and moving around and flapping wings and making calls and all that kind of thing. But all of those rituals are mating rituals, and they're all about connecting one animal to another, identifying an animal as part of you, part of your species, and then coming together in a very intimate connection to mate, to propagate the species. So ultimately, if all animal rituals are mating rituals, that's based on sexuality and the sexual process and the mating process. Well, then that has something to do with all of the rituals that then became part of humanity. And so that's really what led to this idea of sex god in the brain, which is that if we really think about it from an evolutionary perspective, the rituals that are a part of our religious traditions, our educational systems, the political systems that we're all watching, they all derive ultimately from these mating rituals that we find in animals. And hence, they are deeply rooted in the sexual urges, the sexual energy that really makes us who we are as human beings. And to me, it makes sense. I mean, especially if you're thinking about religion as being perhaps, between religion and science, these are the two most powerful forces that have guided humanity. It makes sense that they would be, that these kinds of rituals and these practices would be embedded at a very primal level of who we are and kind of tap into the energy and the power that sexuality has for us. And of course, we see certainly in the early religious traditions that, they're all about fertility and creation and so forth. And that creative force is really what sexuality is all about. So the sexual and the spiritual impulses that are within us seem to derive from the same basic components within the brain.